Namaste and welcome back. In the last video, we have seen the various classes of ethical hackers. Based upon the proficiency skills possessed by the hackers, how the categorization will be made have been seen in the last video. Next, we have seen the use of internet and social media is the one of the main reason that hackers will enter into the target organizations or target networks to steal the data and thereby to lead to data breaches. Then we have seen broad steps that are followed by the hackers to take the control of or to gain the access of the targeted systems. So in these phases, there exists broadly five phases available. In that, first two phases are said to be pre-exploitation phases. Those are information gathering and scanning. Then the third phase is said to be the exploitation phase. That means gaining the access. And the fourth and fifth phases are said to be post-exploitation phases. That means the objective of the hacker is reached and he is trying to clear the tracks so that it will be the access path to the target system is not identified, cannot be identified by any security audit. So these are the five phases which are very, very important that every hacker by and large will follow. In this video, I will be presenting to counter these hacking attacks, how the ethical hacker will play a major role in counter attacking or identifying and suggesting the countermeasures to avoid the hacking by the hackers. So in this I will be explaining what is the role of ethical hacker, what are the other roles available in any organization which are related to the security, and how the ethical hacker should be prepared himself technically and non-technically to identify the hackers' attacks, and also what are the other knowledge that an ethical hacker should possess to safeguard any organizational network is going to be seen in this particular video. So let us start.
In the last video, we ended up with the discussion of hacking phases. Understanding these hacking phases is very, very important for the ethical hacker. The reason is ethical hacker will also think in line with the hacker in order to identify the objective and the losses that are incurred by the hacker once the system is compromised. Hence, ethical hacker is also required to learn these five stages. So in this, the phase 1 and phase 2, which are said to be pre-exploitation phases. Here, exploitation is nothing but identifying of the vulnerabilities in any services or the applications that are running on the target system and exploiting those vulnerabilities in order to gain the access to the target system. Hence, the first phase and second phase are said to be the pre-exploitation phases. It nothing but the hacker will do lot of work or research about the target system and will gain as much information as possible from outside, and that is passively or actively, so that he will figure out what are the suitable networking tools or hacking tools can be used so that he can identify the vulnerabilities on the target system. So that is the reason The phase 1 and phase 2 are the utmost important, because any misunderstanding or miscalculation done in the phase 1 and phase 2 may be known to the security auditors or maybe the security managers at the organization level, that somebody is trying to scan our organizational networks, and they may become alert, thereby they may do all other necessary actions so that the attacker may not enter into the target network. Once the first and second phase is successful, first and second phases are successful, then the very, very important concept here is the exploitation of the vulnerabilities. This exploiting of the vulnerabilities may result into cracking of the passwords or escalating of the privileges and accessing of databases, etc. So once the gaining of the access is done by the attacker, then the target system or target network will be under the control of the hacker. Then the hacker can do whatever he wants to do or whatever the damage he can do for the target system. So that is the reason phase 3 is said to be the exploitation phase. While coming to the phase 4 and phase 5 are the post-exploitation phase. Once a hacker exploit any system and got his required information or his objective is achieved, then he never leaves the accessed system as it is. However, he will try to place some backdoors or trojans or rootkits so that he can again access the same target system in future. For that, he will try to hide the tracks in what way he entered into the target system. It is just like think of a robbery. The robber who wants to rob a particular property will gain the information about the property actively or passively. That means he may get the information from the general sources, or he may personally go in different form there and investigate about the property. Then he will gain the information of what are the tools and other things or other support is required in order to rob that particular property. Then he will figure out the necessary tools and methods that are required for robbing the property. That is what the phase 1. Then in phase 2, he will apply those tools. Or sometimes in the first instance itself he may get the success, or sometimes he has to go for repeated number of attempts to get the success. So that is the reason in the hacking process also phase 2 is very, very critical, because no hacker can directly get into the system in the first attempt. Always the hacker will be so patient, and he will wait for sometimes days, months, or weeks or months together to hack a particular target system. So in the same way here, how the robber will try to try different alternatives and attempts to make his robbery success, in the same way hacker will also do almost all sort of techniques he will apply in order to get the vulnerabilities of the target system. So once, in the same way here, once the robber got the access, or once he got the loophole of that particular area in order to rob the property, obviously he will gain the access into the property area. Then he will try to rob the or steal this property. He may not leave the tracks like that. But finally, in what way he entered into the property area, okay, that particular area may be covered with any other alternative procedures that he will follow, or any other techniques he will follow, so that the investigators or police cannot identify in what way he entered into the property area and robbed and went out. So this is what thing called phase 5, hiding of the tracks. Once the hiding of the tracks is successful, the same robber may also enter again and again into the property area whenever he wants. So this is the same. You have to correlate how the robbery incidents that we usually see in our in the newspapers, or in maybe commonly we listen from others. In the same way, technically speaking, the hacker will also try to enter into the target system by performing the information gathering, scanning, gaining of the access, maintaining the access, and by finally hiding the tracks. So these are the hacking phases. So by and large, every hacker, even an ethical hacker, will also follow the same steps. So far we have seen what are the wrongdoings of a hacker, how a hacker will impact any organization or a target system, and the intentions of the hackers, classes of hacker, hacking procedures. But now we move on to the what is meant by ethical hacking. So the wording is quite interesting. Here it is not a hacking procedure, but it is a ethical hacking. The name itself telling you that the hacking activity that you perform ethically is said to be ethical hacking. Here ethically means legally. That means by granting the permission by concerned authorities. If you perform the hacking, then such hacking is said to be ethical hacking. Here, concerned authorities are nothing but the heads of the organization, or the government, or any other managerial positions of a company or an organization. So, a hacker, a professional who gains the permissions to hack a particular network for identifying and verifying possibilities and existence of exploitable vulnerabilities in a developed system by an organization. That means here granting the permission of by a manager or a organizational head to identify vulnerabilities of other companies' developed systems is said to be hacking. But ethical hacking is nothing but a company will hire a professional who will be given charge to identify and verify possibilities or existence of any exploitable vulnerabilities in the systems that are developed by that particular organization. So, in this context, ethical hacker is an individual or a freelancer or maybe a consultant that are hired by an organization to identify and verify possibilities or existence of exploitable vulnerabilities in the systems that are developed by that particular organization. In general, any system is going to be developed with some systematic procedures. Like, just to recall the procedures of the software engineering, first requirement elicitation, next requirements analysis, then planning, design, testing, and deployment, maintenance. So these are the various stages that will happen in developing any product. Here, many organizations develop the products of their specialization, maybe databases, maybe web applications, maybe websites, maybe any other things like operating systems, etc. So these applications are developed based upon the software engineering principles normally, and the testing process will also go normally according to the software engineering principles once the product is developed. That means the designing of the product will happen, then coding will happen, the expert coders will code the application, then the product will be developed. At the elementary level, the developer itself will test the application, then the senior level people will test the application, then the third party testing team may also test the application. But even after performing these tests, there may be some hidden or unnoticed loopholes or weaknesses may be available in the developed systems. So that is reason when these applications are running over the network or may be connected by with the internet or may be vigorously used by a lot of people, that means the objective of that particular product is to be used by many of the users, then the concerned organization will hire some people like the experts who are very very good in the using networking tools, who are very good in analyzing the security related things. So they will hire them. That person may be an individual or may be a freelancer. He may work for multiple companies or organizations, or a specialist organizations. Maybe they are maybe consultants to many of the software development companies, or maybe a specialized application development organizations. So they will hire these people, and they will give the task of identifying of the existence or identifying of the what you call vulnerabilities, possible vulnerabilities in the systems developed by the particular organization. So in this also, the product will be given to the professional that who hired for this particular task. At the same time, there will be a legal agreement between that particular professional and the organization. According to the legal agreement, the professional, in our sense, it is who are the ethical hacker, has to perform the identification of the vulnerabilities and report those vulnerabilities to the organizational heads. So this is the way how the ethical hacker will play a defensive role in identifying and explaining those vulnerabilities to the organizational heads, so that the security team or maybe the developers team will try to develop some patches or maybe rewriting of the code with some security features, or enhancing of security patches attaching to that particular existing software product may be done by the organization. So here, in one sense, the ethical hacker will use his technical skills for positive purpose, whereas a general hacker will use his technical skills for negative cause. So If you ask me, I can say that ethical hacking is just like knowing martial arts. When we are learning any martial art, maybe karate or kung fu or maybe boxing or maybe taekwondo, in the first class itself, they will teach us that whatever the martial art that we are learning is for defensive purpose. The defense of self may be defense of others. So the martial art that what you are learning is not for offensive purpose. So if you use these martial arts for the offensive purpose, you will be the culprit. But if you use for the defensive purpose, you may be the god in others' point of view. So in the same way, whatever the technical and computer networking skills that you have acquired, if you use it for the good cause, then you will become the ethical hacker. But if you do it for the negative cause, then they are said to be the hackers. Hence, ethical hackers will also think like a hacker to perform his tasks positively. That is for positive cause. So, unless until ethical hacker don't know what hacker is doing, he cannot design a counter plan to defend the hacker's activity. So that is the reason ethical hacker will also think in line with the hacker to perform the tasks assigned by the organization. So most organizations recruit the ethical hackers, especially to do the following tasks. First one is uncovering of the vulnerabilities. No one can predict these are the vulnerabilities that are available in the given product on the fly. But there will be a standard operating procedure or standard operating check will be done by each and every ethical hacker to uncover vulnerabilities. If any vulnerability identified via standard operating check, then those are the general vulnerabilities which are available in the market or which are available to the public databases, from which anyone can browse through those vulnerabilities and can launch exploiting of those vulnerabilities. But if other than the listed vulnerabilities, if they try to identify a completely new vulnerability from the system, from the developed systems or developed applications, then such vulnerabilities are said to be zero-day vulnerabilities, which are completely new, nowhere those vulnerabilities are available. So those are said to be zero-day vulnerabilities. Next is to understand the hacker's target. Once the ethical hacker knows the possible vulnerabilities that are available in the application, then he can completely understand what are the targets of the hackers that the hackers will go into the organization based on these vulnerabilities. Once they understand the hacker's target by identifying those vulnerabilities, the ethical hackers will suggest some policies to strengthen the security of the particular product or the application. So that is the reason strengthening of the security policies based upon the suggestions made by the ethical hacker, the organization's security team may sit together and go for discussion and brainstorming along with the ethical hacker, and they may design some security policies to strengthen what are the existing policies. And finally, to improve the network protection and the end user policies. Sometimes some policies can be directly handled by the organization, but some policies must be given to the users to do that. That means any social media user want to protect his data, then some protection policies will be available in that related social media sites, so that the user has to know those security policies and has to enable those security policies, then only that particular user's data will be protected. So like that, some end user policies, that means some policies will be given to the end user, so that he has to manage those policies or he has to set those policies. Otherwise it is not it is very difficult for the organization to manage those things. That is, that those policies should be wholly maintained by the end user. A simple example is, if you might have purchased a router, by default the username and password is set to admin and admin. But this is the basic requirement of any router manufacturing company to provide a software for protecting their Wi-Fi. That is, the default password what they set is admin and admin. But the end user policy is, they should not keep always admin and admin as the username and password while it is in operation. That means the default passwords and default usernames should not be set at any time once the end user purchases that particular product, because it is the general username and password that is known to everyone. But the end user, what he has to do is, he has to change the security policy or security password. He has to change it so that no one can understand, no one can recognize it unless until he say publicly. So this is the way how the end user policies will work. At the same time, end user policies in the Facebook, end user policies in the Twitter. So once you go through these end user policies, then we'll come to know what are the security arrangements that end user has to make for himself, so that his data cannot be leaked out. Like how the Facebook will give the protection of not to disclose the user's mobile number. That means the mobile number can be shared publicly or privately. Okay, when the user set his mobile number to be shown publicly, then it will be shown publicly. Anyone can access his mobile number. So this is the way how the security policies to be set by the end users. So with this ethical hackers suggestions, organization can do whatever the best they can do at their end. After doing all the best things that they can do at the organization end, the leftover things, that means what are the policies that cannot be done by the organization should be done by the end users. So the reason here, organizational policies and end user policies, two things can be decided, two categories can be divided, so that the organization will do their best in completing the organizational level policies. So by this time you come to know that how the role of ethical hacker is important in identifying vulnerabilities in the products developed by any organization. Now we'll see some discussion on the role of the ethical hacker in the organization. As we are discussing that, the ethical hacker will also think in line with the intruder. Here, intruder in the sense attacker. How the attacker will think, in the same way ethical hacker will also think. This kind of situation you might have seen in many movies, like how the hero of that particular movie will think in line with thinking of the villain of the particular movie. So in many of the movies, the hero will think in line with the villain and will make a counter plan, so that the villain's activities can be stopped.
So this is the way the hero and villain activities will go on in many of the movies. In the same way, here ethical hacker and hacker will be having the same kind of relation, that the hacker will sketch some plan to enter into the target system, but the ethical hacker will also think in line with the hacker, so that he will try to make any he will try to suggest or make some counter plan so that the intrusion can be stopped. Next one is identifies what an intruder can see on target system. So how an ethical hacker can see that what an intruder can see on the target system? So this will cover the first and second phase of the hacking, that is information gathering and the scanning phases. Here ethical hacker will also do both of the phases, so that the ethical hacker will also identify what an intruder can see on the target system. That means the ethical hacker will also perform the scanning activity on the target system. The scanning activity will be very vigorous and will use high accuracy tools, so that the ethical hacker will identify that what an intruder can see on the target system. That means the hacker will perform the first and second phase at his end. At the same time, ethical hacker, when he is searching for the vulnerabilities on the target system at the organizational side, he will also do the same task, but with the high accuracy tools to identify what an intruder can see on the target system. That means hacker will do the first and second phase, at the same time ethical hacker will also do the first and second phase here. Next role of the ethical hacker is he will identify what an intruder can do on target system. In the previous point, the ethical hacker is doing the phase 1 and phase 2 of the hacking steps, where in case of this point identifies the what an intruder can do on target system. That means with the identified vulnerabilities in the previous step, ethical hacker can predict what are the access, what are the different accesses, or how the hacker will gain the access to the system, and what are the possible attacks that he can launch on the target system. That means ethical hacker here will do the third phase, gaining of the access. That means he can predict how he can gain the, that is how the hacker can gain the target system. So this is the way how the first phase, first, second and third phase will be done by the ethical hacker. Next, he will assess the success or failure of intruder's attempt. That means the intruder has performed this thing will be done after identifying something was happened in the target system by the organization. And the ethical hacker will come and will do the first three phases, and he will say that okay, because of these vulnerabilities and exploitation, these are the features or these are the services that may be get disturbed, or these are the attacks that may be launched by the hacker. So in that manner, the ethical hacker will search for whether such attempts or such attacks were launched by the hacker or not, so that ethical hacker can assess the intruder or hacker's attempt is success or failure. If it is success, then obviously there will be privilege escalation or maybe some password cracking that might be done over there. But if it is failure, that means no privilege escalation was done, or log records will not be might have not changed, or these kind of things the ethical hacker will identify. So this is the another very very important point, because the hacker can sorry ethical hacker can identify whether the hacker how much time this particular hacker or intruder was stayed in the target system, and what are the major destruction done by the hacker. Okay, these all the things can be predicted by or assessed by the ethical hacker. In order to assess the success or failure, the ethical hacker will also try to uncover the tracks. That is how the hacker will do the covering of the tracks, that how he entered into the system. The ethical hacker will also predict, okay, this may be the path via which the intruder entered into the system. So he will go in reverse of that particular path, and he will identify the exact path from which the intruder entered into the system. So that exact path is the entry point into the target system, so that the entry point might have observed because of the some weak security policy or the very poor protection of the application. Okay, so that is reason. In the next point, the ethical hacker will assess the level of the protection of the system. Whether the based upon the security features that are offered by the application, the assess level of the protection will be assessed. That the level may be a low level or a medium level or high level. Some categories will be provided, and if any specific loophole was identified, then that will be intimated to the organizational head or the security team. And finally, what he will do is he will estimate, that is ethical hacker will also estimate the time and effort required for fixing the gaps. Here gaps in the sense the vulnerabilities, that is loopholes. So he will also assess what are the different how much time it will take to fix that particular gap, because some applications might have launched because of the competition between the various organizations. And if this kind of hacking was observed all of a sudden on the newly launched systems, obviously because of the competition, the organization may lose lot of business. So that is the reason fast fixing of these particular loopholes or vulnerabilities is much essential. Because already in the market, other competing application is running on, so that the users are much attracted towards such applications. Thereby, the effort placed by this organization may be go wasted. So that is the reason the ethical hacker role is also to estimate the time and effort that is required for fixing these gaps. So based upon the time and effort, they will assess the developers. They will approach, that is organization will approach the developers and security team, and they will go for redesigning or designing of some new patches. Then thereby immediately this patch will be released as a security update, or maybe the upgradation of the existing system, maybe any other thing. Finally, the ethical hacker will analyze the security standards of the system. So many systems or whatever the systems or applications that are developed by the organizations will follow some security standards. It may be data protection standard or maybe any other security standard which is renowned and which is accepted internationally. So these security standards will be assessed, will be analyzed by the ethical hacker. So that with the estimated security standard and based upon the level of protection of the system, ethical hacker finally concludes that what are the other upgradations that the system is eligible to do, or system need to be upgraded, or maybe patches may be created, or whatever it may be to the organization. So in this way, the role of the ethical hacker is crucial while identifying the vulnerabilities on the developed systems or applications in an organization. So ethical hacker may be hired, or maybe a freelancer, maybe a consultant. So that is the reason the role of ethical hacker is so free, and we can say is so white collar, and at the same time so challenging, because even if ethical hacker do any mistake in identifying vulnerabilities, then again the organization has to lose a lot of business. At the same time, the ethical hacker's reputation will also go down. At the same time, organization reputation will also go down. So the reason ethical hacker is a ever learning person, or they cannot say that I have learned these many things I no need to learn further. So he is a daily learner. So ethical hacker is a daily learner and a daily practitioner. So that is, otherwise it is very difficult for the ethical hacker to identify and explore the vulnerabilities in the available systems or the assignments are given by the organizations. So to fulfill the role of the ethical hacker in a full-fledged way, he should possess some skills. So we'll see now what are the skills required for an ethical hacker. Basically, a general hacker may be good in technically, but the ethical hacker, from the defensive point of view, he should have the technical skills just like a normal hacker, but at the same time he should also have non-technical skills. So what are the technical skills he must possess? First one is knowledge on the networking. So an ethical hacker must be very good in the concepts of the networking. Here networking in the sense computer networking. It may be computer network or maybe wireless network or maybe wired network or maybe any other personal area networks like Bluetooth and other things. So the technical skills must be required. These are the networking skills must be required for the ethical hacker. So these are not normal. We cannot rate these skills as normal skills, but extraordinary networking skills is required. Next one is knowledge on the operating system. At least two operating systems like Windows, which are very popular, and the Linux operating system. So if you want to be an ethical hacker, parallelly you must also acquire these skills, at least like operating system administration, like how OS administration will be done, like users creation, users deletion, accessing of the access control list preparation, or firewall settings, installing and uninstalling. So these are the basic administrative responsibilities of an operating system. So these must be known to the ethical hacker. At the same time, he must also know the various security tools, using of the security tools, maybe from the command prompt, maybe a graphical user interface, maybe proprietary, maybe open source. Some standard security tools must be known to the ethical hacker. Next one is knowledge on the security policies. So the security policies will change over time based upon the new technologies, new requirements. So the ethical hacker must also be, as we have discussed previously, the ethical hacker should also be an ever learner, so that he must be updated to the news. He must be updated all the time, and his knowledge must also be updated with the new security policies that are designed and implemented internationally. Next one is non-technical skills. The non-technical skills in the sense here, one is loyalty. So the ethical hacker must be very loyal in doing his work jobs. What are the assignment given by the organization? The reason is if he miss any one of the point, for example, he might have explored the vulnerabilities and found that some of the vulnerabilities reported missing. So these kind of things may lead to identification of these vulnerabilities by the attacker, and attacker again may come into the organization network for launching any security attack. At the same time, ethical hacker must be so loyal to say that whether this can be fixed or not. See, that means it's like straightforward and very loyal that it should not harm the organization, because organization has trusted the ethical hacker to identify the vulnerabilities in that application what they developed. Next one is learning ability. So ethical hacker must be always enthusiastic and to learn, should be interested to learn some new technologies, tools every day. So by the end of the day, if you want to be an ethical hacker, you must say that, okay, I have learned this tool with these points by the end of the day. So like that, every day some new things, new techniques should be learned. So that means learning ability, the fast learning ability is required here, and at the same time interest to learn also required for the ethical hacker. Next is update on new tools, because at the time of learning the ethical hacking procedures, you might have learned some tool of version 1.0. The same version cannot be used after 2 or 3 years also. So the new tools may come, or the existing tools versions may be upgraded, new features may be added in that. So those things should also be learned by the ethical hacker. Next one is work ethics. Work ethics are very, very important for the ethical hacker, because these non-technical skills will be missed in the hacker, but it should be possessed by the ethical hacker. Next one is the knowledge of the law of the land. This is utmost important, because wherever you do the ethical hacking, if the organization resides in India, then they must know the Indian laws and standards, or Indian laws like Information Technology Act, etc. If they work in some other countries, then the law of the particular land should be known to the ethical hacker. Otherwise, ethical hacker may be in trouble if anything was gone wrong while exploring the vulnerabilities, and organization may file a case against the ethical hacker also. So that reason, before starting up the ethical hacking activity, that is whenever the organization gives the assignment to perform some exploring of the vulnerabilities or verifying of the vulnerabilities in an application, they will go for a legal agreement. So at least to write that legal agreement and to understand the legal agreement, the ethical hacker should possess a knowledge of the law of the land. So these are the non-technical skills that must be possessed by the ethical hacker. And obviously technical skills, like how normally every security analyst and security programmer or developer require, in the same way the ethical hacker must also possess the technical skills. So to summarize this video, in this video we have seen what is meant by ethical hacking, how ethical hacking is important in the organization, how much important the role of the ethical hacker in any organization, and what are the roles of the ethical hacker in identifying of the vulnerabilities in the given application or given system. At the same time, what are the skills required for ethical hacker to possess? The ethical hacker requires like normal hackers and security analysts, they should also possess the technical skills. At the same time, they should also possess the non-technical skills like loyalty, learning ability, work ethics, knowledge on the law of the land. Okay, these are the things must be possessed by the ethical hacker. So, normal hacking and ethical hacking, by this time you might be knowing the difference between the normal hacker and an ethical hacker. Ethical hacking is just like learning martial arts. You have to use it for the defensive purpose. Since you are using for the defensive purpose, you should also know how the offender will think. So that reason, ethical hacker will also think in line with the hacker and also perform the same hacking steps to identify the vulnerabilities in the application or system that was requested by the organization for exploring and reporting those vulnerabilities. So ethical hacker is positive and defensive side, and hacker is negative and at the offending side. So rest of we'll see remaining other concepts in the next video.